Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Mindfulness with Ru. I'm your host, Rupinder Malia, and today I have two more trailblazers with me on my show. Sharing the screen with me is Ms. Dhwani Jain and Dulapo Adigun from Nigeria. I'll welcome both of you. I'm so thankful to you that you took out time for me to become a part of this show. Let me introduce my guests for the reference of the viewers. So here we have the first guest, Ms. Dhwani Jain. She is the founder at Karma Foundation. She is the state president of Women's Indian Chamber of Commerce and Industry. She is an engineer, social entrepreneur, and motivational speaker. She has represented and led the Indian delegation at BRICS and SCO Youth Conference. And she has been part of the jury at Global Chamber of Commerce World Business Awards. She is also the ambassador of Metaspace. Welcome, Dhwani. Welcome to Mindfulness with Ru.
Thank you so much, Rupinder, for inviting me. It is such a pleasure being in your show.
Thank you.
I'm looking forward to the entire conversation.
Let me introduce my second guest for today's interview, and she is Ms. Dulapo Adigun from Nigeria. She is going to appear on this show for the second time. Well, talking about Dulapo, she is a writer, researcher, podcaster. She is the founder of the NGO Diary of an African Child Organization. She has been writing for the grassroots level people in African countries. And especially she is concerned about the girls in her country, right? And if I talk about the works of her NGO, they have been doing a wonderful job by initiating campaigns like Pad Up the Girl Challenge to end the period of poverty, and also to eradicate gender imbalances and to empower African children through self-development courses and encouraging them unleash their potential. Welcome, Dulapo. Welcome once again to Mindfulness with Ru.
Thank you.
All right, so let us start today's session. And Bunny, I'll start with you.
Thank you for having me. A wonderful pleasure.
I'm so glad to have you on my show, Dulapo. So, Dhwani, you have done engineering, and today, you're a part of many business forums, as I was reading the profile and everything, as well as you're a part of some NGOs and social organizations. How did this journey start? What inspired you towards the social work?
Oh, that has been a very casual journey. So honestly, as a child, I never thought of getting into entrepreneurship. And engineering was definitely my choice for education. And that has really helped me in this journey as well, because the education that you get never gets wasted, right? And It has helped me develop a scientific temper. And why I turned into social entrepreneurship, there's so many fault lines in the society. And I have also worked with the corporate sector. And while working, I realized maybe I was earning a lot, I was financially very stable, but I was not giving back to my society. So that always hurt me. Everything I was doing was for myself. But that was the time I decided that I have to do something for my nation, for my people, and for the world at large. And therefore, there was this gigantic shift from being a corporate employee to a social entrepreneur. And that is how Karma started.
Great. So this was only my next question was that, what about this Karma Foundation? If you can throw a little bit of light on it.
Yeah, so Karma is a very interesting concept. Generally, it is taken in a negative connotation. But for me, karma means the power of our thoughts, words, and actions. So any change that we think of bringing in the society starts with a mere thought. And that is exactly how my journey started. I thought of bringing about a change. I spoke to the people who mattered in my life initially, and then to so many other people. And finally, I took this action, that is to start my journey in social entrepreneurship, and therefore I kept this name Karma. And I feel we as human beings can make any change in the society, in the world, we can actually make an impact through our actions, and that is our karma.
So true.
That is how it started.
Viewers, even as I told you that Dolapo is running an NGO in Nigeria. So Dolapo, now my next question is for you, that what inspired you to come up with an NGO like the Diary of an African Child organization?
Sorry, I didn't get that.
What inspired you to come up with your NGO? Diary of an African Child organization.
Okay, as a child, when I was growing up, there was a lot of teenage pregnancy in my society, and I wanted that to end. I wanted to change, because there is more to a woman than becoming a wife and a mother. So I just wanted that to change. I want to see women reaching their full potential. I see women adding coins. So I wanted all those things to change. That's what really inspired me to start the Diary of an African Child.
All right. And you and Dhwani are actually soul sisters. And I want to ask one by one, both of you, that how did this relationship start? How did you get connected with each other? And then, like, how did this all start?
Dolapo, would you say first?
Actually, we can't explain it. Me personally, I explain it. So I believe it's divine. Because I have a twin sister. My twin sister died when she was a few months old. I even told her that maybe you are my twin sister that came back. So I cannot explain it is divine for me.
Right. And Dhwani, what about you?
Honestly, like she said, it has been a divine connection. And I would call her like a younger sister to me. And this has been the greatest blessing of COVID, to be honest, you know. Mm-hmm. We have made so many relationships during COVID times. Virtually, we have never met. But I don't feel like that I've never met her. I'm sure there must be some past life connection or whatever it is.
True.
We definitely share a wonderful connection. And we look forward to make some meaningful contribution in the world together.
Mm-hmm. So whenever I have any kind of interaction with Dolapo, it's like rarely it goes without your discussions over there.
She's a darling.
Talks about you, that how much she admires you and how much she appreciates your work. And that, that is why I was curious to meet you and to invite you also and to interact with you.
It means a lot to me, honestly.
So, she is doing such a great work in Nigeria, right? A lot of things are required in that part of the world. And you are running an NGO here in India. What do you think? Do you see any kind of similarity between the needs of women based in African countries and over here in Asia?
So to be honest, I feel in spite of all the talks about gender equality, women empowerment and stuff, honestly, in any part of the world, true gender equality is not present.
Yes.
So maybe there might be some minor changes as per the society, but definitely we as women must come together. We'll have to come together to make it a more equal world. And when I say an equal world, I am not talking about a women-led world. Honestly, I'm not talking about it. And in fact, I always say, you know, the eagle does not fly on one wing, right? It flies on two wings. And men and women are just two wings of the bird. And we have to work together. And this is the problem of every society. Because we as humans have the tendency of dividing ourselves in, you know, I, me, you, yours. And that is, gender is the most visible form of discrimination, and hence it is very difficult also to get over that. But girls, women across the world, and why only girls and women, even men need to join this movement and work together to build a more inclusive world.
So true. And Dolapo, what would you add into it? Like, what similarities do you find? Of course, the physiological similarities are there, but the needs, requirements, social and emotional, what similarities do you see? If you talk about the women, if you talk about the women of both the countries, Africa and like the place where you are, Nigeria and India, what do you think? What are the like main requirements or any kind of similarity in their needs which you feel?
Yes, for example, the girl that I started, a lot of menstruation is not a choice. Women all over the world menstruate, they have their periods. Say that there are a lot of similarities in that aspect. There is poverty in Asia too, in some Asia countries. So we have to just come together and tackle women issues. That's what I feel. Did I get it?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. So Dhwani, like she is doing a wonderful job by creating this kind of a work, like Pad Up a Girl Challenge and everything. And I saw you also participated in that. Your Karma Foundation also participated and contributed into that. What do you think that the campaigns like this can really change the shape of future for the future generations?
Of course, I mean, any campaign would at least make people start thinking about the issue. So earlier periods, even in our country, was an issue, like, you know, tabooed issue. We would not talk about it in open. We would still not discuss it with our fathers or brothers. And once we run such a campaign, it becomes a normal issue. I mean, there is nothing wrong in menstruation. That is a natural process. Mm-hmm. So it has to be normalized, and campaigns like that definitely normalize it. And I feel periods has been a major challenge for women across the world. In fact, when I talk about India, there's so many women who have to leave school just because when they start menstruating. Yes. So these are issues that women across the world face, and such campaigns would definitely create awareness and maybe more people join hands and ensure that the period products are available to women from different socioeconomic backgrounds at a reasonable price. And that is exactly what we are doing.
Indeed, it is required, yeah. And Dolapo, I want you to like explain in detail, like, what is your organization doing during this campaign of Pad Up the Girl Challenge? I really want you to explain it in your own words. I think due to some connectivity issue, the voice is reaching late to her. Dolapo, are you able to hear me? Meanwhile, Dhwani, you can throw a little bit of light on the works of Karma Foundation. What all things so far have you done through the Karma Foundation?
Honestly, in the last 1.5 or 2 years, all our activities have been COVID relief activities. We are primarily focused on that. And it would start from something as simple as providing dry ration kits or cooked food to the displaced daily wage earners, to provision of oxygen. So during the second peak of the COVID pandemic, we procured medical grade oxygen from Europe and provided relief in far off areas as far as Eastern UP, Uttarakhand and Delhi, slums in Delhi. So that has been the major project. Apart from that, I'm also working with women self-help groups. We are training them, we are supporting them in marketing their products. And definitely a lot of workshops with youth, children, women, so that they are motivated to do something on their own and be Atmanirbhar, like our Prime Minister says. So working on that direction to skill India and to make them Atmanirbhar.
Yes, so this was my the next question for you was like, when you talk about Business Skill India, and you are a part of this chamber for commerce and industry, so like, how can like the women who are not even aware about all these chambers and everything, how do you people make them aware about them and help them out if they want to start up with something?
So that is exactly the purpose of the chamber. We have realized that women in metros still have a lot of knowledge and awareness around the government policies, but women in tier 2 and tier 3 cities do not have that kind of knowledge. And even when they have knowledge, they do not have access to technology, or maybe they are ill-equipped to function in that way. And we are reaching out to them through different mediums. We are reaching out to them through social media. We organize some physical workshops as well, and just trying to do our bit. I know it will take some time because it is a long drawn process, but we have to start somewhere, and I'm happy that the beginning has been done.
All right, Dolapo, I want to ask you to tell us more about this Pad Up the Girl challenge.
Okay, this part of the girl challenge, you want to take part in it. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
So it's for everyone to take part. I believe if every one of us takes part in it, a lot of girls have asked access to sanitary pads, so period poverty will actually reduce to the minimum. So that's what the challenge is about. So I'm requesting everyone to pass in it. Gift a girl child 1 pound every month so that we can eradicate poverty.
Even this term periods poverty, like, it's a strong word, and I think now with the advent of words like this, the generation is going to be like more aware about all these problems. You won't believe, today just in the morning I was watching a video about menstruation, so they were not having any proper answers for it. So what do you think, Dhwani, like, what can be the contribution of men towards it?
That is so, disheartening that we segregate such things between men and women, you know. This is a natural process, and it is a part of giving birth to a child, something so important. The whole human chain is dependent on reproduction, and menstruation is just the first step. So how can men not know about it? And therefore I say that it is so important to have a conversation around these topics. Yesterday I was in another webinar, and we were talking about this, that few years back, even when an advertisement would come of a Whisper or a Stay Free, we would just look here and there. Oh my God, my brother is here, my father is there. Good thing is, at least somehow that is changing. Even today, the shopkeeper would give you the pads in a, black wrapper, or
black wrappers
in a newspaper, and further put it on a black plastic and then give it to you. Something which is so natural, which is, I would call it divine also, because that is the basis of human existence. And we have made it a taboo. That is sad. We need to include men in this. We definitely need men. And I'm happy that we have certain men who are openly talking about it and trying to create more awareness. I'm just hoping that in the coming years, more men would join the team, and we will be able to end period poverty.
Yeah, we are quite hopeful about that. And Dolapo, I want to ask you that, what is the contribution of, the males around you, the friends and family? How do they see your work and like the kind of campaigns you are running? Are you able to hear me? Her connection goes.
Maybe you can just type out the question to her.
Yeah, I will. I will definitely type out the question to her. And meanwhile, Dhwani, I want you to now put some light on the issue of these gender imbalances. When we talk about like women empowerment and everything, and nowadays we are seeing some women are trying to take advantage of this thing too. So what do you think? Should we be focusing more on women empowerment or gender like equality?
I have always said that we need to create a gender neutral world. It cannot be a man's world. It cannot be a woman's world. Like I said, we are just two wings of the same bird. We have to work together. Of course, of late, we have seen a lot of women misusing the laws also. And honestly,
can you come again? They are doing
Yes, Dolapo, you can reconnect. You can reconnect.
So when a woman does that, she's actually creating a lot of problem for a lot of other women, because then people tend to just classify women like that. Mm-hmm. And even the genuine cases in that case, you know, just move out of the focus. As women, I feel the responsibility lies on us. Mm-hmm. Because whatever laws have been made for our benefit, we must use them judiciously. True. It is on us, definitely. And we have to. So, you know, every right comes with a duty. Every right comes with a lot of responsibility. Similarly, mm-hmm. any law that has been made for us has to be with a lot of responsibility. We need to use that. Mm-hmm. Not only for us, but for the future generations, for our daughters, for our younger sisters. So, yes. The onus lies on us. Not on anybody else. And I always tell women that being a woman is your strength. A lot of times I've seen women cribbing about, you know, I have to take care of my family, I have to take care of my daughter, my son, this, that. So I would rather tell them that your children are your strength. You need to create a support system. You need to have a conversation with your husband, with your parents, with your in-laws, and create a system like that. And make your family your biggest support rather than a disadvantage.
Yeah,
that has to be your advantage.
True. Yeah. True. And it will change, like it cannot change overnight, but with the passage of time.
Interestingly, a lot has changed, if I be honest. I mean, I'm seeing men participating more in the family. I'm seeing men promoting women.
Yes,
there are people who still have those stereotypes and everything. But again, the onus lies on us. I mean, if I, as a woman, can contribute meaningfully, I will be an example not only to women, but also to men. And they would start looking at women in a more positive way. So whatever freedoms we have got or whatever opportunities we have got, we have to make use of them. 200%.
Yes, and very rightly said. Very rightly said. And what do you think, what is the like role of education over here? Don't you think the root cause is lack of education underneath every issue?
Absolutely. Number one thing is education. But when we talk about education, definitely it is not only going to school and learning reading, writing and arithmetic. Mm-hmm. So I don't call it education. That is just rote memorization. A very holistic education, I would rather say, is required. And that must include the concepts of gender equality, gender balancing.
Yes.
Value education, real life skills, and all that. We cannot just focus on math, science, English, and Hindi. That is not going to do any good.
Very true. I was just seeing like if Adi can join us. This is the issue, this network issues usually come with her. I hope you're able to hear us, Dolapo.
Yes, I can hear you now.
Very good. We are so eager to talk to you and listen to you. So I was asking you, Dolapo, that what is the contribution of your the male colleagues into your campaign, Pad Up the Girl Challenge?
We've been sending funds because they are probably like to go, and they said they can't just, like, one of my friends said, you can't just go and give a girl a pad, that the girl, it will. So they've been sending funds to support the campaign, and some of them are also coming out to speak on the campaign, like Panom, the guy from South Sudan. So a lot of my male friends will be coming out to talk about the challenge, but most of them have been sending funds for us to do the challenge for them.
Right, so they are helping her with the funds and they are actually contributing into it. And Dolapo, I also want to ask you, like, when we read your blogs, so there you have mentioned the need of education, and Vani and I were talking about the need and importance of education so far all the social issues are concerned. So what do you think, how important is education?
Education plays a very, very major role in the society. Like, let me give an example. If I didn't talk, probably I'm not supposed to all these things. I will not be able to read. I'll not be able to write anything. So, I got the question. So I will not be able to read. I will not be able to voice for all these people that I'm giving voice to right now. So education plays a very major role in the society. It gives you exposure. It gives you the ability to do things. It gives you self-confidence. So I believe every one of us, everybody should be educated. And we should keep grassroots people that are not educated. We should keep looking forward how to educate them. We should keep creating projects to educate the grassroots people. Because it's only when we are educated that we can actually make a change.
Very rightly said. Yeah. So Dhwani, if we talk about, like earlier we were discussing that women empowerment, of course, and gender equality. Don't you think that in our own country, there are certain, parts of society where women, they enjoy like a normal life, good education, like people like us who were fortunate enough to go to school and complete their higher education and go for the jobs they wanted to go for. But then one start of society is at grassroots level, if I talk about rural areas where they do not get the basic primary education also. So what do you think, what is the contribution of, the governmental organizations or these NGOs, of course, their contribution also, because you are a part of one NGO. How do you think that this imbalance can be made to be into some kind of balanced platform?
The government and the NGOs are doing a lot of work because the primary reason why girls are not sent to school is because particularly in the lower socioeconomic background, when they have limited resources, they would send their son to a school rather than their daughter.
Yes,
and that is primarily because they think that the son would probably start earning and then support the family, whereas the woman, the daughter, will get married and she has to take care of the household activities. So number one, the education has to be government funded. It has to be free education for all. And the government is doing a lot of work in that direction.
Yes.
Interestingly, the Delhi schools, I am in Delhi and I've seen the Delhi schools improving so much that everybody is happy to send their children to government schools.
Yes.
We need to improve the infrastructure of the government schools across the country so that it becomes the norm rather than, out of majburi, or rather out of out of poverty you don't have to send, rather the education quality is so good, and that is one important aspect. The other, we have been talking about period poverty, we have seen that the enrollment ratio of girls suddenly decreases at the age of 13-14 at the time of puberty. So we need to have washrooms, ample number of clean washrooms in school, safe environment at school, so that people, the parents do not ask their daughters to leave the school. Mm-hmm. Third issue is that schools could be far off from the village area, and yes, there's a lot of travel time. So again, we need to provide the commutation to the girls, safe commutation. There have been cases when women are going to school and they have been kidnapped, raped, or things like that. So we need to have a more strict law and order system so that the crimes that are happening against women, they are in control. It is sad that even today, I mean, even in the metros where we call ourselves educated, even then we don't feel safe after a certain point of time.
Yes.
So these are three, four things that we must give more importance to. And as NGOs, we need to create more awareness. Definitely, we have to make the parents understand that, yes, probably the boy will support you, support the family financially in future, but daughters are not burdens. And in fact, you know, when you teach one woman, you teach the entire family. So we have to think in that way. We have to think in a longer term, and then only we can make a difference.
So true.
It has to be a sustained, I mean, continuous effort. We cannot take things overnight.
Yes, I agree to that. And Dilapo, I want you to like tell us that what are the general problems related with education there in Nigeria in general, for both boys and girls?
Okay, I would say we are in a progressive society here in Nigeria. Barely will you see youth not going to school, except they are very, very, very poor.
Okay.
They don't have funds to go. So I'm crying, although education is not so free in Nigeria, because you still have to pay a token. A lot of people still don't have access to that token that they have to pay. So I believe as time goes on, education will be totally free, so that everyone will have access to it. And also, Nigerian government need to work on, because personally I can't send my to a government in Nigeria, to work on the educational system of the country, like building more classrooms and more schools. So as time goes on, I believe things will change. People are standing up against all these things. So I believe get to change, and my NGO too, we are working on things towards that aspect too. So as time goes on, and we have free education for all in Nigeria.
No, really, we feel that the kind of efforts you are putting and the kind of programs and campaigns you are coming up with, I hope that you are able to inspire other Nigerian girls to come forward and contribute into it. And it will happen, I think. If you can do it, anybody else can also. So I think you are a kind of role model for other women and girls in the society around you.
Thank you.
And what kind of help do you think people can provide your NGO? Like, even if they are not sitting in Nigeria, they are around the world, anywhere on the globe, how can they help you?
Just type.
Tell us, how can we help you?
Sorry?
Tell us, how can we help you?
I really appreciate Kama Foundation for coming forward to participate participate in the Stand Up A Girl Challenge. At least that's a step forward. So I hope it will inspire other people to come forward and do the same thing. Because, you know, it's different countries, so it's not that easy. If you are doing the same thing that we are doing, if you are participating in our project, it will inspire other Nigerians. Because they will be like, okay, I'm a Nigerian and she's participating in this project. I too have to participate. So it's a step forward in motivating all Nigerians that if someone from outside the country can participate, not keeping them from participating. To thank Camp Foundation once again for coming forward in this part of the girl thing.
Yes. Indeed. So Dhwani, what do you want to add into it? Don't you think she's doing a wonderful work over there in a place like Nigeria?
She is definitely doing a commendable job. And I can, say so many things, but then it might look like she is like my younger sister. So it might look influenced by the relationship that we share. But definitely, she's doing a wonderful job. And honestly, it is my privilege that I'm able to support the Paddle for Girl Challenge. Mm-hmm. And like you said, it is a kind of ripple effect. Maybe you do not help us directly, but even if you do one good deed every day and share it with us, it gives us a motivation to do much more. And your one action would motivate thousands of other people. So every step matters. Even if you can't support us directly, just do something good for the society from your time as per your schedule. Mm. And I can say a lot of things for Dolapo, but the show will get over. So I just wish her all the luck and all the best for all of future endeavors.
Yeah.
I'm sure.
And it was also quite amazing. When we were the other day discussing about the things related to her NGO and other things. And when we were talking about the issues related to women, we found so many similarities that the same things we face here in India and likewise they are facing in Nigeria. So it like these, if we see geographically the distance, it's far. But if we look at the condition of women, it is the same condition over there also.
That is the sad part, but that is the sad reality. That's the truth. And women across the world, like I said, gender is the most visible form of discrimination. So it is happening in every society in one form or the other. The reasons could be different. I mean, in India, it could be because of traditions. In some other country, it could be because they are too materialistic. So, but those differences are there. And, even in US, it took so many years for the developed country like US to have the first female vice president. So women across the globe are facing that. We have to break the glass ceiling. We have to work towards that. Yes. The good thing is we have got the opportunity. Our generation has the opportunity to make the mark. Mm-hmm. Let's make full use of that. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad to have two of you who think alike and we can together do so many things.
No, really, I think that we need to empower each other. And if we come together as some kind of a group of thinking, like-minded people, then only the situation can change. Yes. Dolapo, would you like to add something into it?
Okay, I want to appreciate you for giving me another chance to come on your show. It's such a wonderful pleasure and brought me here with my sister. Oh my God, I'm very excited about it. So I just want to encourage everyone to participate to support us generally. Anywhere you see us, please just support us. We need your support. Your support will go a very, very long way. Thank you very much.
And my last question now, Dhwani, I want to ask you, as you've been part of numerous jury related to business, right? And I want to ask you that what piece of advice would you like to give any woman who wants to come up with some kind of business of her own, startup of her own, other than like the emotional support, what all things are required?
A very simple advice I give to every woman. Number one is follow your passion, follow your heart. You know, there's so many people who would come and tell you, you can't do that. I mean, I have faced so many people who were telling me, this is not a woman's job. Why are you getting? So even before I got into engineering, some of the very educated women told me, oh, you know, engineering is a male dominated field. Why do you want to do a, why, even if you want to go for engineering, go for information technology or computer science, why chemical engineering? So people will come, don't be a prisoner of society's thought. Go ahead, do what you feel you can do the best. And as far as other things are concerned, I feel we as women do not take charge of the financial matters. That is very important. You cannot be, I mean, you can have a support system, but you need to learn things yourself also.
Yourself.
Because in general, society thinks that women are unaware of a lot of things. And therefore, they try to make take advantage of that. You need to be aware of things. Maybe you don't handle everything yourself, but even to get the work done, you need to know them. So have basic knowledge of different domains and then start your work without thinking of what the society will say, what people will say. Do what you can do the best. Just don't
this, you know, I really agree to the statement, and there are so many like things related to this using, you know, a debit card, credit card, going to the bank, like becoming aware about the banking terminologies or everything. And even like at home, don't you think like since childhood that if it is like news on the TV, then it is the father's thing, and if it is a serial, then that's a mother's thing.
And that is how we create that gender differences in the family. Yes. I mean, that is how children learn that.
Why don't we also see the election polls and everything, that which party is winning, who is behind, who is ahead, who is the leader for any party or something, who is the president or prime minister of any country or something. I think we ourselves do not come out of those chains.
But that is how society is shaping us. And therefore, we need to make the change. In fact, you know, since we've talked about politics and relations, so, you know, as women, the primary role has been maintaining relations. And I strongly feel more women should come into politics, because if women are there in politics, we are attuned to have good relations with each other. So I'm sure we will have good relations across the world, across states. Imagine there are 26 women chief ministers. They are interacting and trying to solve problems through dialogue rather than through legal things or something like that. And it would be a more happy place.
It can be like more female leadership should be there around the world.
Empathy is our strength, right? And that is exactly the core area where leadership is based on. So why not have more women as leaders?
Then only it will create a balanced world. It's an imbalance, more of masculine energy over there, and that feminine is very less into the scene.
The problem is we go for just token appreciation. We have one woman and all of us go gaga about it. Oh, you know, so-and-so woman is at such a high position and she's leading a team of 100 men. Rather than that, I would appreciate the fact that a woman is leading a team of 50 men and 50 women or something like that. That is a more inclusive thing.
So true. So it was a wonderful interaction with you, Dhwani, and Dulapo. I think Dulapo, again, some connectivity issue is there. So one last message for our viewers.
It was such a pleasure being on your show. The last message would be keep supporting us. Keep doing something good in your life. You might not have that much time. Whatever time you have, give back to the society something, whatever best you can do. And Rupender, thank you so much for inviting me and Dulapo together to your show. It was indeed fun for me. Rather than anything else, it was so much fun for me. And definitely, it was a very enlightening session. I thoroughly enjoyed interacting with you. And Thank you so much. All the best to you too for all your future endeavors.
Same here. And I really wish you luck for your future endeavors. And whatever you are doing, you're doing a great job enlightening the society, enlightening other women. And you are really a role model and really a trailblazer. Thank you so much.
Thank you, viewers.
This was Dhwani and Dolapo. They really are trailblazers. Dolapo is doing a wonderful job sitting in Nigeria, you know, educating the women around her about their rights and periods, poverty and everything. Likewise, Dhwani, through her foundations, organizations and all her works, she is an inspiration for all of us. She's motivating others to come out of their shackles and just break the chains and be whatever you want to do. So I promise you to bring another trailblazer during the next episode of Mindfulness with Ru. Till then, good evening. Goodbye.